Humans often like to think they know the world pretty well. Aside from maybe the deepest abysses of the ocean, humans have kind of stretched across and invaded seemingly every corner of the planet, and in doing so have explored the wildlife in a lot of these areas. Birds, in particular, are relatively easy to find and observe most of the time, so it's not that often a new species is discovered in this day and age. The advancement of phylogenetic technology frequently causes existing taxa to be split into new species, but this isn't really a true discovery, right? I'm talking about something much more pure, an entirely new bird that has never been described to science, a species that no birder or ornithologist has ever knowingly laid eyes on. Today we're going to talk about one of these. This is the story of the Inti Tanager. As well as we know the world's birds, believe it or not, entirely new species are described to science every year. Some years are particularly prolific. In 2013, 15 new species of birds were discovered in one part of the Brazilian Amazon alone. But all of these, along with pretty much every newly discovered species these days, is a very close relative of something existing already that we already know very well. So surely this Inti Tanager I'm talking about isn't that interesting then. I mean, there's probably some other well-known tanager that looks just like it and is very closely related. Oh, wait, it's a new member of an entirely new genus? Oh, okay, well that's pretty cool. Fair enough, but still. I mean, this has happened a few times in the last 100 years, including a couple other times in the tanager family. Most of these discoveries are in remote mountain ranges or areas where people haven't been before. So I'm sure this one isn't any wait, hold on. It was found smack in the middle of one of South America's most heavily trafficked birding destinations? Well, I suppose it's safe to say that the Inti Tanager is pretty unique. And it's quite a nice looking bird as well, look at it. To get a better gauge of how unique this bird's story is, I went right to the source. I figured there's nobody better to talk to than the person who first discovered it.
I would gather that you didn't necessarily expect to find something completely undescribed at the time.
Yeah, that's an understatement.
Daniel Lane is an ornithologist currently working for the LSU Museum of Natural Science and having done a lot of tour guiding in his career, a very experienced neotropical birder. As a young, aspiring ornithologist, he got the opportunity to search the neotropics for new bird species while working with LSU. And on one of his first trips out, he struck gold.
It was a program where they were doing investigations in the tropics of the Americas, mostly in South America and Peru and Bolivia and so on. And they were finding new species of science. And I that blew my mind. On the very first one, was the lucky guy who got to see the new bird of the expedition, you know? So that was a great start. I honestly believe that was probably the best and worst thing to happen to a 22-year-old kid, because you're not supposed to achieve your lifelong dream at 22.
Yeah.
It's a little young.
Dan and Gary Rosenberg were leading a tour in the Peruvian Andes in October 2000, when out of nowhere they heard a confusing and unfamiliar song coming from the forest. When they caught a quick glance of the bird in their scopes, they had no idea what to think.
I was hearing in the background this bird song. And having never been in the region before, the thing that was coming to mind based on that song was a yellow throat, the masked yellow throat, which is this fairly widespread sort of trash habitat bird. I was kind of just sort of ignoring that sound, until this bird flew up and landed on the very top of a dead snag, pretty tall one, on top of a hill, and started doing the song that I'd been hearing. What I was seeing did not compute. You know, it's I'd already kind of learned most of the birds that would be likely in most of Peru, though. I think, whether I'd seen them already or not at that point, I sort of have at least seen specimens and knew what roughly to expect. Nothing was coming up in my, you know, Rolodex as to what this could be. But it was a canary yellow bird with a bright pink bill and a black eyebrow and no other obvious characters. And the only thing I could come up with on, you know, at the spur of the moment was, you know, there are these Asian and African aureolas.
Right, right.
That have kind of this vague pattern. So we called the Barry Walker. Is that he looked in the scope and all he could see was this, you know, bouncing branch. The bird had just departed the moment before he looked in. and it flew over the ridge and vanished.
And then it was gone. For years, Dan and Gary struggled to come to grips with what they had seen, even beginning to doubt that they had seen anything at all.
And this thing kind of stuck with me. And so I sent copies of the sketch I'd made to anybody I could think of. Repeatedly, people were just giving me like, this isn't anything I know. You know, after a couple more years, we were going back doing the same route on the same rough dates for 2 or 3 years in a row and never encountered this thing again. And at that point, we basically, I was starting to wonder myself, did we really see that right?
But eventually, they would see it again.
And then again in 2003, on the same tour, same exact spot, same bend in the road, we were coming around the bend with Gary and I were co-leading another tour, and I hear this thing singing off in the distance, and I turned to Gary, I said, that's our bird. And so we walked up to where this voice was coming from. I got a recording of it at quite close distance, played it back, and the thing popped right up on top of a tree and just gave us all incredible views. And that was when we really were like, okay, this is something new, clearly new and interesting, and we better start working.
Now they knew for sure. It was official. This was a real bird, a new species, and they had the documentation to prove it. But this happened 18 years ago. How come the manuscript describing the species and putting it on the taxonomic map just got published? It might not seem obvious right away, but believe it or not, convincing the entire scientific community that you've discovered a new species of bird in a place where people go all the time and have never seen it before is a long process.
But to name a new species, you need to have some tangible documentation of it to be able to, first of all, say that it's real and to compare it to related forms. And it's a fair case to have something that is so distinctive that you don't actually know what its most closely related forms are.
They still just hadn't seen this bird enough. But how are you supposed to do that when it's so goddamn elusive and hard to find? I mean, Dan was in the right place at the right time twice in Peru, but tons of people had gone there and not seen it, so what's next? Well, somebody else was about to be in the right place at the right time once again, although this time the place was over a few hundred kilometers away in Bolivia.
But then this all became clear several years later when an associate of mine, Frank Wright, was doing field work in Bolivia and found a population of these birds breeding in a deciduous forest valley in La Paz, Bolivia. And so he got in touch with me, he revealed this to me, and he basically said, you know, I think he'd already sorted out this thing's most likely going to be migratory. You know, it kind of makes sense. Other folks had been in this valley most in the dry season and not reported this bird, and he said it was abundant. So they're either deaf, because apparently the song, you know, was all over the place, or the bird wasn't present when they were there. There's the story. And that really suddenly just like makes this a whole new phenomenon.
The discovery of the Bolivian breeding grounds paved the way for nearly a decade of intense data collection, where ornithologists collected samples for genetic analysis, made notes about the bird's life history, and surveyed for potential breeding territories. At the forefront of this initiative was Ryan Terrill, currently a postdoc at Occidental College in California studying birds. His field experience made him a key figure in observing and documenting the Inti Tanager.
When it was found, when Frank Wright found them breeding in Bolivia, I was actively working in Bolivia, so I was kind of the one that had the connections and the permits and you know, the on-the-ground know-how in Bolivia. So when we decided to mount a expedition to go try to find this thing, I was kind of the only guy doing, you know, bird work in Bolivia at the time. And so that's kind of how I got involved, was, you know, doing logistics for the trip and making the trip there happen. Apolo is a small town. It's a, you know, 22-hour bus ride from La Paz. And then to get down into the Machariapo Valley, it's another few hours from there. But the problem is you have to cross a river. And so everybody, I mean, there only had even been a couple trips into the, you know, like scientific expeditions into there. Mark Pierman went on one. And even Ted Parker had been in there too. But both during the dry season, because there's this river that you have to cross. And you could ford it and then walk a few more miles, but I don't think anybody ever wanted to do that. And so what we did is went right at the beginning of the wet season before the river is too high with a van that has like a snorkel so we could get in and out.
Ryan has lots of great memories about the birds as well. I mean, he's seen so many, right? They really are one of a kind.
I mean, they are very territorial, which is pretty cool for like a neotropical tanager. You know, a lot of the tanagers are flocking birds and you see them in flocks and stuff. But, you know, when you think of a bird that like the male sits on territory and sings and defends it, you know, it's more like ant birds and stuff like that. And so that's pretty cool to see. And that's pretty unique. They sing a lot and they sing late into the morning, which was one of the first things that gave us the idea to, you know, make the name some sort of play on sun tanager. Cause like, you know, dawn, there's the whole dawn chorus, and especially in dry forest, it gets pretty hot and stuff quiets down. And then after that, you know, 9:30, 10 in the morning, it's basically just black-capped ant wrens and Inti Tanager singing. They sing pretty late into the morning often.
As Ryan mentioned, the bird's name was inspired by the sun. It's a bright yellow bird, it looks like a sun. It sings when the sun is high up in the sky, and it sings up in the tree close to the sun. The word Inti means sun in the Quechua and Aymara languages that are spoken by indigenous peoples in the area.
Not just calling it sun tanager with the English word, but actually using Inti, I thought was kind of nice. You may be familiar with there's been a bit of a cultural revolution, I suppose you could say, with names and kind of trying to involve indigenous cultures and so on in. And so it seemed, you know, like Quechua, the word Inti would just be a pretty great way to try to be more inclusive in the name of this bird. And it sounds kind of cool too.
There was no shortage of other proposed names, including San Pedro Tanager, which it kind of sat as an e-bird for quite some time, and Kill Bill Tanager, which, I mean, I guess I'm too young. I don't really understand the reference. I've never seen the movie. Dan also had one other runner-up that I kind of thought was interesting as well.
Actually, one bird or one name I was really considering was the El Dorado Tanager, because this bird's frustrating history in many respects struck me as being similar to the legend of El Dorado, you know, this place that you can get really close to it and then it just slips through your fingers and this, you know, you can't find the treasure in the end kind of thing. And this bird had been sort of doing this to me for a while. And you know, I sort of asked several friends in Peru and in North America, they're like, yeah, that sounds like a great name. But then one of the co-authors sort of said, it does sort of smack slightly of colonialism.
So now that we know where this thing is, what does the future hold for this unique little bird? According to Ryan, things are looking relatively good. It's quite common on the breeding territory and doesn't seem too picky for habitat.
The first trip we were there, it seemed like we were there as they were returning to the breeding. We were there like at the beginning of the breeding season, at the beginning of the humid season. So when we first got there, it was like, we went out all day and then we finally had one. We're like, oh my God, it's a, you know, this is awesome. And then by the time we were leaving, it's like we'd play playback and like three males would all come in and start fighting and stuff, you know, and they're just like, and then as we were leaving, you know, we were in this really gorgeous dry forest and we're like, okay, this is clearly their habitat. And then as we were leaving, we stopped and birded a couple places and we kept getting out and it's like, oh, they're still here. And it's like the last place we had them was just, you know, real junky and we didn't think they'd be there and they were still there. And so it seems like, you know, it's not a huge population. It's a pretty small area, but yeah, they are really packed into this small area. Some of its range is protected. A lot of its range will be protected. It's an area that is slated to eventually become part of the Mid-Ed National Park.
The Inti Tanager is truly one of a kind. When it was first seen, it confused even the most experienced ornithologists and rapidly developed into one of the most intriguing mysteries of the bird world. Now, over 20 years after Dan and Gary first caught a glimpse of the bird, the mystery has been solved. Phylogenetically, it's a tanager, but it sings like a yellowthroat and defends its territory like an antbird. Even its migratory behavior is unique among its closest relatives. Seemingly every way, this bird is unlike anything else known to science. And for those hoping for another mystery to solve, there's good news. The experts in the field think that there's more out there to be discovered.
Do you think that there's something else, some other bird that's just completely unlike anything else that we know, that's just somewhere hiding in some mountain range or some valley somewhere in the world? Do you think there's something out there to still be chased?
Odds are that, yeah, there probably, I mean, there's still so much of, you know, the world that is not really, really well known. Even though birds are perhaps one of the best known groups of organisms in the world at this point, I would not be at all surprised if there is still a new genus level form out there waiting to be discovered.
I wouldn't doubt that there's something as or more unique creeping around out there somewhere, just have to find out before it goes extinct.
Thank you all so much for watching this video, and a special huge thank you to Daniel Lane and Ryan Terrill for making this possible. They were both amazing to talk to, and they've done some incredible work to get this species on the map and get it described. If you haven't done so already, please click subscribe to my YouTube channel. I've got a lot more coming out in the future, and you don't want to miss it. You can click the little notification bell if you want as well, and that way you'll know whenever I upload. Leave a like if you enjoyed this one, and make sure to share with someone who likes nature and thinks this might be cool. Bye-bye now.